So let me focus my intervention on three keywords that have been raised by Dean Sonobe, by Professor Gassimli, as well as Amar. I think those three are climate fatigue, and second one would be the gap between ideas and implementation, and last but not least, the need for more private sector financing. So those are the topics that I think will be very much important, and I still also believe, like what Nicola mentioned, the role of think tank in making the climate finance would be more feasible and affordable for especially a developing economy. So let me focus on two areas of possible climate financing. The first one would be blended financing, and the second one would be carbon trading. So let me start with the blended financing. So I think blended financing has been discussing for quite some time, especially dealing with the climate change issues. But then, as previous speakers mentioned, there has been, I think, a quite significant gap between the ideas behind promoting more blended financing, directly or indirectly, and the real implementation. And if you look at the discussion during the COP and during many of multilateral forum, I believe whenever people talking about climate financing, majority of discussion will be focusing on public finance or the source of from public funding. Of course, public funding will be very important, but it cannot be the main source of climate financing itself. I fully agree with what Amar mentioned, that we need more private financing. But then, the bigger question, especially for emerging market and developing economy, how can we facilitate private financing to come into the countries that categorize as EMDE, emerging market and developing economy? And of course, what they need is for public financing to be catalytic financing, meaning that public financing is expected to be the part of the co-financing scheme that can lower the interest rate. That's number one. So public finance basically serve as a grand part of the blended finance. I think if you look at the blended finance in general, it will cover grant, concessional funding, guarantee, and the private financing itself. So in order to private finance to become the majority, the major part of the blended finance, then we need the grant, and the grant, I believe, can come not only from public finance, from the budget of each government, it can also come from the bilateral grant, for example, the grant from a developed economy to the less developed economy, as well as the philanthropy. So I believe the so-called non-government side in this discussion already raised about the importance of the philanthropy. But then the role of public financing is still critical. And then certainly the reform of MDB is very critical, because aside from the grant, you need concessional financing. And the biggest source of concessional financing is no other than the MDBs. So if there is a report mentioned by Nicola and Amar that the MDBs is a bit behind in the reform, not only development financing in general, especially in the climate financing, maybe they are kind of limited by lack of commitment from the major, so-called the major sponsor of MDBs, which is a developed economy, then of course it will reduce the potential of private financing coming into emerging market and developing economies. And then of course the other part that MDBs can play a big role is the guarantee. Because again, the private financing, of course, they have, you know, they have a lot of sources for financing renewable energy, energy transition, and any climate mitigation in different emerging and developing economies. But then there is a de-risking factor that so far is a little bit absent. And that's the reason why private sector, whenever they say that we already launched or we already investing in renewable energy or in green economy in general, majority of recipient will be developed economy itself or investment in Europe, investment in America and different parts of the world. And of course, this is not the case because de-risking is not there, and that's the reason why private sector sometimes avoiding the idea to come into the developing economy. And of course, there has been, yeah, of course, there has been effort by several members of developed economy trying to facilitate the private sector to come into developing economy through different scheme that also involve grant and concessional financing. At least for Indonesia case, there is a JETP, Just Energy Transition Partnership. Of course, JETP is a good start for blended financing implementation because it has grant, it has guarantee, it has concessional financing, and it has private sector as well. But of course, when we look at the structure of JETP, in the case of Indonesia, for example, the amount of the grant is quite small. I mean, people in Indonesia complain, yes, JETP is good idea, but why grant is so small? Because then with the small grant and the concessional financing is also still, you know, in progress. I think ABB has made a good progress with the early retirement of coal-fired power plant scheme. That will be good for supporting the idea that concessional financing can attract more private sector coming into green energy, let's say in Indonesia. But then, guarantee not yet clear. Although MDBs like World Bank, like ADB already have their own guarantee agency or guarantee scheme. But so far, in my observation, it has been behind. While guarantee is very important, at least to accompany the concessional financing, accompany the grant in order to do the de-risking factor of private sector. So I believe de-risking, I think, is the area in which think tanks, both in developed economy and developing economy, can promote not only to the respective country, but especially to the international institution. How can international institution promote more de-risking factor for private sector, in general private sector, in order to invest in green energy in emerging market and developing economy. So that's the area of blended finance, I think, that should get more priorities. I mean, not only from government, of course, government will be important, but sometimes government too much focus only on the public sector financing scheme. So they just care about how to get more grant, how to get more loan, rather than trying to create the scheme of blended financing that eventually will attract much more investment coming into the area of green energy. On the second issue of the carbon trading, I think a couple days ago, COP29 already reached a consensus on the standard for Article 6.4, establishing dynamic framework for international carbon markets. This mechanism allows developed countries to meet emission reduction targets by purchasing verified carbon credits from developing nations, effectively channeling resources to where they are most needed. I think this is a good alternative. I mean, of course, blended financing will be ideal, but we know that there are still a lot of things to be done in order to make blended finance working. Why don't we go to the something that kind of more feasible and maybe more implementable? Doing the trading. Somebody has the ability or willingness to buy, and the other has willingness to sell. And the commodity is the carbon credit itself. And we know that many developing economies could potentially be the provider of carbon supply. I mean, the decarbonization element supply. So it means there could be a potential in which the developing economy, in order to do their energy transition, how to promote green economy, rather than just depending only on the blended financing scheme, private sector investment in their country, they also being more aggressive in order to so-called sell their ability to provide carbon credit, get some so-called fresh money, and that kind of money, of course, can be invested to start shifting the energy from the fossil fuel into renewable energy. And I heard, Professor Gasimli mentioned about the fossil fuel subsidy. So of course, this is another area that could be complementing with the carbon credit, in which any country that still has relatively big fossil fuel subsidy can start, you know, leaving this fossil fuel subsidy and shifting into, maybe we can call it either subsidy for renewable energy or incentive for renewable energy. So if we can shift from subsidy to incentive for renewable energy combined with the potential carbon market, I believe there could be alternative solution for financing green energy, especially in the emerging market and developing economy. And again, this can only be done if think tanks in the not only G20 members or developing economy, but also think tank in G7 can work together. So at least if the government cannot, you know, agree on something, I mean the government of G7 and G20 cannot agree on something, at least the think tank hopefully can facilitate to bridge the sometimes misunderstanding between developed economy and developing economy. Because if we are promoting, for example, this carbon trading more aggressively with the one that just, you know, agreed on COP29, then it's basically also kind of support from developed economy to developing economy. But this is transaction-based, this involves the market, and not only about, I agree, not only about charity, not only about giving the grant. I think relying on the grant, relying on charity, I think will only last very short. So we need to make something that is continuous. Everybody agrees because this is basically market-based. So that's maybe the end of my intervention, and we hope that we can promote more the ideas of financing for green energy from both blended financing and carbon trading. Thank you very much.